qualità, di qualità. Very proud of, and very proud to be associated with them, and very proud that they are members of our company. The lady is Elizabeth Hines. She's a native of Michigan and graduated from Indiana University. She made her City Opera debut in 1976, and since then she has sung such a variety of roles. I want to list them for you because I think you'll see the astonishing versatility of our artist. She's done Susanna in The Marriage of Figaro, Pamina in The Magic Flute, Musetta, Krista in The Micropolis Affair, Michaela in Carmen, of course, and the title role in Naughty Marietta. Now, you just can't go crazier than that. She has sung with opera companies and symphony orchestras throughout the country. And in 1981, she made her Chicago Lyric Opera debut as Marcellina in Fidelio, and followed that with Despina in Così fan tutte. And future performances include Despina in Miami, and the title role in Menotti's Amelia Goes to the Ball in Dallas, and who cares about all that? The main thing is that the City Opera this season, her roles are Mimi, Pamina, Michaela, Musetta, and Yum Yum in our new production of The Mikado. And even more important than all that is that in 2 weeks, Elizabeth is going to get married to Chris Hartman, and we're really very happy for her. We all have approved of him. We think he's very nice, and so it's okay. The tenor who is joining her for this first act sequence is Franco Farina, who joined our company on tour in Los Angeles last fall as Pinkerton in Madame Butterfly. And that's the role he will sing at what I consider his official City Opera debut on August 21st, because I like to consider City Opera debuts on the stage of the New York State Theater as the real McCoy. He's a graduate of Oberlin Conservatory of Music, and he's a native of Trumbull, Connecticut. He's appeared with opera companies across the country in Tulsa, Pittsburgh, Central City, the Spoleto Festival in Charleston. He's got a lot of future plans in Chicago, a lot with us, and the biggest future plan he's got is going to marry one of our sopranos, Nadia Pelle. And now they're going to sing for you the first act sequence from La Bohème, Elizabeth Hines and Franco Farina.
Si la lasci
I'm sorry you couldn't see their final stage kiss, but I think it's the perfect moment to take a little station break, and we'll be right back. We're back in the wonderful performing studio at WNCN. You just heard Elizabeth Hines and Franco Farina do the first act sequence, and now we're going to move into Act 3 and hear the quartet. So Elizabeth and Franco are going to be joined by Karen Hofstadt and Dominic Costa. Karen Hofstadt made her City Opera debut this past season in the title role of The Merry Widow. She's a beautiful redheaded girl, a native of Peru, Illinois. I'm delighted there's such a place. She studied at Illinois Wesleyan and Northwestern University. Her recent performances have included Donna Anna in Des Moines and Magda in La Rondine, and the Countess and Thea Musgraves, the voice of Ariadne, and the title role in Flotow's Martha with the Chicago Opera Theater. But most important of all is what she's going to do with us at the New York City Opera. And this season, her roles include Micaela, Rosalinda, the Merry Widow, and Magda in our new production of La Rondine. And of course, she's joined by Dominic Costa. Dominic is not only an old pal, but he's a member of the City Opera family for over 20 years and has created leading roles in 17 of our new productions. A native of Jessup, Pennsylvania, he studied at the University of Detroit, where he received a master's degree in psychology, which must come in very useful as a singer. He has sung with major opera companies and symphony orchestras throughout the United States, made his European debut at the Teatro Nuovo in Milan. This July, he'll sing Figaro and the Barber of Seville and Escamillo in Hong Kong, Singapore, and this is my favorite place, Kuala Lumpur. But after that, he returns to the City Opera on August 6th for performances of Falke and the Harlequin in Ariadne of Naxos. Falke, of course, in the Fledermaus. He will create the role of Pishtash in our new production of The Mikado, which opens on August 30th. Never helps to sell, hurts to sell a ticket. Anyhow, following our City Opera season, Dominic goes to Italy for performances of Riccardo in I Puritani. So now you're going to get the third act quartet with Elizabeth Hines, Karen Hofstadt, Franco Farina, and Dominic Costa, again accompanied by John Beeson.
Thank you.
Now, Mr. Franco Farina and Mr. Dominic Cossa will sing the beautiful Act 4 duet from La Bohème.
C'ho gusto da me, dai alla, ma chi rodi e ridi non batte bene. Io pur vidi,
Rosetta,
dimmi, l'hai vista, ma guarda te la in carrozza vestita come una regina.
E viva le giangante.
Guarda si strugge l'amor.
Lavoriamo. Che pena infame.
Che infame pennello.
We're going to have to break away in just a second, but before we do, I want to tell you that it's okay for you to listen to this live concert now, but as soon as we finish, we want you to act by calling 496-0600, because otherwise you're never going to get to see and hear these wonderful singers in person. So for now, I'll let you off the hook while we have a station break. We're back in the wonderful performing studio of WNCN. We're going to hear one of our new artists, a very lovely-looking young woman by the name of Louisa Jonasson. She's joined us just this past year. She's from Minnesota and studied theater at Moorhead State University, and I'm probably the only one who knows where Moorhead is in this room. It's right next to Fargo. And she studied music at the Juilliard School. She was a finalist in the Met Opera auditions and made her professional debut with the American Opera Center at Juilliard, singing Norina in Don Pasquale, which was directed by Giancarlo Menotti. Louisa has been a Santa Fe Opera apprentice and has sung the title role in Madama Butterfly with the Virginia Opera, and she's got future performances of that role scheduled for her in Anchorage, Alaska. Don't say we don't get around. But tonight she's not going to do Butterfly for you. She's going to do Tosca, that very wonderful second act aria, Visi d'Arte. Louisa Jonasson, accompanied by John Beeson. Last season, Judith Haddon sang the title role in the highly acclaimed City Opera production of Madama Butterfly. It was seen on national television as part of our participation in Live from Lincoln Center. Judith's debut with the City Opera was in the spring of 81 when she sang Zerlina in Don Giovanni. And since then, she's added Micaela to her City Opera repertory. She's a native of Cincinnati, was raised in Chicago, and is a graduate of the University of Illinois. She's sung with the major opera companies in this country, including those of Houston, St. Louis, Dallas, Pittsburgh, Seattle, and Omaha. I'm exhausted. And is also a leading soloist with symphony orchestras. This season, her roles with the City Opera will include Liu in Turandot, Mimi, and Butterfly. And tonight, she is going to repeat a very small segment of her television triumph in Madame Butterfly, 2-2-2, Judith Haddon. We're going to take another little break now, and don't forget, 496-0600, we're going to be expecting you to use that to order some of our summer sampling.
I'm starving.
Since then, he has filled his tummy and has sung many roles with us, including Hoffman, Pinkerton, Cavaradossi, Turiddu, Albert Gregor in the Micropolis Affair. His European debut came in 1973 at the Spoleto Festival as Des Grieux in Manon. Was that Puccini or Massenet?
Puccini.
Puccini, that's good. A role he subsequently, after all, we are pushing and selling Puccini, a role he subsequently repeated with the Metropolitan, Pittsburgh, and Hawaii Opera Companies, and he's going to sing it again, incidentally, this summer in Cincinnati. Highlights of this past season included performances of Alfredo in Portland, his first Otello in Cleveland. We have to talk about that. Rodimus and Aida in Mississippi, and Manon Lescaut in Cincinnati and Pittsburgh. But most important is that he returns to the City Opera this season, singing the Calaf in Turandot and Don Jose in Carmen. And for us tonight, he's going to sing the very beautiful aria, Ch'ella mi creda, from Puccini, Who Else, La Fanciulla del West, Harry Thayer. Karen Hufstadt, that very beautiful red-headed young woman I told you about before, is now going to sing Qu'il bel sogno, the aria from La Rondine. We're going to take another little break, and then we'll come back for some more Puccini. What better way to end our evening with an aria from our opening night opera? Guess by whom? Puccini, Turandot, sung by Harry Theon, our brave tenor. He's going to sing Nessun Dorma. Vincero, he did. Now, if that doesn't tempt you to get right on the phone this minute, 4960600, if that doesn't tempt you, nothing will. We've pulled out all our big guns. That's it. Now, run right away and buy that summer sampler immediately, or you're going to miss out on one of the great treats. Come spend the summer with us. We'd love to have you. And I want to thank Judith Haddon, Louisa Jonasson, Karen Hofstadt, Elizabeth Hines, Franco Farina, Harry Theod, Dominic Corsa, John Beeson, I love you all. You're beautiful artists. It's a joy to listen to. And I think you staying at home really missed not being able to see them as well. So come to our theater. We'd love to have you.
Il bianco, Great opener to our New York City Opera special. Judith Forst, Non più mesta from La Cenerentola. Robert de Kunick, the pianist. Judith, welcome back.
Thank you very
Greetings.
Much. Good morning.
Yeah, you're awake now.
Well, I am now. I'm ready for rehearsal.
When do they make you rehearse over City Opera? I mean, is that a morning activity?
Morning, there? Afternoon, evening. Yes.
Anytime.
We're not particular.
Now wait. It's just a minute. It's not slave labor. You know, it's just 10 to 1, 2 to 5, and 7 to 11.
That's all. No, we get time out to eat.
That's right.
Yeah.
How does it work, actually? What, you will be singing, I haven't really looked at the schedule too carefully, but you will be singing Cenerentola at the time that you are rehearsing Norma.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Now, how does that work?
Well, carefully. Very carefully. No, but we've talked about that already, and we've arranged so that when I'm singing Cenerentola, I don't sing Norma on that day, and not a great deal the day before.
When I talked to Judith about doing these two roles, naturally, she expresses what she feels her problems will be in terms of rehearsing and performing simultaneously. And when she gives me the problem, which is obviously that certain things have to be separated, I then turn it over to the rehearsal department, and they work out a schedule for her so that she, not to our advantage, to have her exhausted for either one.
Well, and more than even being tired, it's the place in the voice where these parts sit. Mm-hmm. And although they are lyric, it's a whole different approach. You know, the norm is much more dramatic.
Yes.
Beverly Sills, one thing that does occur to me, if you go to the rehearsal department and you juggle everything so it's very good for Judith, isn't it then very bad for everybody else?
No, and you know, strangely enough, you see, we are a repertory company. You have to remember that. Now, I mean, Judith, certainly we have to accommodate the placement of the voice and all, but you know, Judy has been with us, and there are accommodations that have to be made on both sides. It can't work out for everybody, but in the case of, let's say, Norma, just as an example, obviously we have to accommodate the two ladies. Mm-hmm. Those are, the bass is a difficult part, and so is the tenor. But let's face it, the ladies need very comfortable shoes that do go on all night, you know, so we choose where the accommodation has to take place, and certainly in this particular instance, the two roles that Judith is doing, the Cenerentola as well as the Analgesia, are roles that have to be looked at very carefully. So that it works, but we are a repertory ensemble company, and they do expect sometimes a bit of a crisscross, and we just try to avoid it whenever we can.
Beverly, as I think you know, I tried to ask you at least one embarrassing question per broadcast, and perhaps this is the time for it.
So soon? My God, we haven't been on for 10 minutes.
Well, you know, I like to get going these. No, but really, one of the things that occurs to me is that you, in the past, seem to have been rather careful to choose repertory for the city opera that doesn't really conflict with the opera schedule at the Met.
We try.
And Norma seems to be one of those pieces. You refer to it as a dramatic one, mm-hmm. and yet many of us look on Norma as one of those pieces that they don't really have to act. You just got to get out there, stand there, and sing gorgeously.
I think that's we certainly have to get out there and sing gorgeously. But it's a grave mistake if you stop and examine the score and look at the text, and now the public is going to know what that text is.
Very dramatic text.
Very dramatic. It really ain't a stand-up and sing opera. And I don't crisscross, but can you, off the top of your head, tell me the last time you heard Norma at the Met?
No, it's been a few years anyway.
Okay, and it'll be a few years before you hear it again there. Therefore, I felt this was the ideal time. I would not have done it if I didn't have the singers for it. There's no point in putting on an opera just for the sake of saying you're going to do this opera. When these two women came, and we have even a very good second cast that will take it over in the fall, but we were able to cast it in depth. So I felt this was the perfect opportunity, and Bunning is mad for Judith singing and loves Stapp and has done the Norma with her. So I think
He's wonderful. I've already gone through it with him, and I mean, to every 16th note, he has an opinion and how he wants it done and the attitudes, and it's
very. Do you like that when there is that much of influence?
Because he tells you all this, and then he says, "Go away now and put it into your voice."
Pick and choose.
Yes, but I mean, he gives you so much. It was the same working with him in Anna Bolena. Because he's so close to the style, you see, and to pick a brain like that it's marvelous.
Judith, what else lies ahead for you?
Oh, busy time. I'm doing Anna Bolena in the fall with Joan Sutherland again, or the television.
And accompanied by our New York City Opera Orchestra, if you don't mind.
I must say, isn't that exciting?
Yes, it is. It's a joint project.
Yes.
We don't fool around.
Yeah, it's exciting. So, and then I'll be back to do more Normas in the fall with City Opera. So.
Well, we're so pleased that you were able to launch our program today so wonderfully.
My pleasure.
Thanks for coming back.
Thank you.
Good to see you. Thank you. One of the other productions, one of the other staple productions, let's say, of the New York City Opera, and one in which we remember you, Beverly, is Lucia de Lammermoor. And what happens when you, contrary to some of the other works that you've been describing, have a piece that sort of stays there indefinitely. Do you try to freshen it? Do you try to relook it, rethink it when it comes back?
Yes, I don't think that you can impose on different singers the same characterization, the same concept. You know, the basic blocking of an opera simply means that it's time to go to the left stage because that's where the light will be. So if you have a brain in your head, you're going to continue to go to the left side of the stage. But what you do when you get there is really where the creative artist comes in. And we don't say, look, the last three ladies who sang Lucia, when they got there, this is what they did. Therefore, you have to do that. We don't do that. I don't feel that that's a very creative process. So the blocking is done in a matter of hours. I mean, the blocking is simple practicalities. This is where you should be. If you want to be dumb enough and sing in the dark, be my guest. But the light is there. Go there. We do not do new light plots each time. So the basic blocking stays the same. But I think the directors work with each person as they come into the role in a totally different manner. You'll find in Lucia, we've had very large ladies. We've had very tiny ladies. We've had all kinds of different women take over the role. And the fun of the City Opera, because it is a repertory company, because it's an ensemble company, is to watch what people do within the same framework, to watch how they paint their own painting inside that frame. Mm-hmm. And I like that a lot. I love to see somebody come up with a totally new idea in an opera that I've been looking at. I mean, after all, I'm looking in front of me to attending at least 130 operatic performances. By the fifth or sixth Lucia, you know, there are going to be very few surprises. Mm-hmm. Nevertheless, every once in a while, somebody starts to experiment on the stage, find a new facet to the character, and it becomes a very interesting evening. I'm very interested in people who once they get there and find the light, suddenly do something very different.
Well, we don't have much of a light here in our QXR Concert Theater, but we do have Harry Dworchak with us. Harry, will you come forward? And Harry, once again, with Robert de Kunick, our pianist, is going to give us an aria from Lucia dalla Stanza.
Yeah.
Mary Dvorak with pianist Robert DeKunick.
And it's awfully early for that.
Hey, I didn't know baritones had to worry about things like that.
Basses.
Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. You got to get the voice up a little
That's
bit.
That's right. Uh-huh. Man once told me a long time ago, nobody pays you for your low notes.
Harry, how do you respond to what Beverly Sills was saying before about seeking new facets in a role? Are you ready to experiment at all? Are you ready to walk out on stage tonight and do something somehow a little differently from what you did last night?
Always.
Yes?
Even in the same production I've done the previous performance, I'll find something different the next one on how I feel. If I feel particularly happy on a particular night, if something's good has happened, I can use that to apply to the character. If I've had a bad day, which we've all had, and you can use that to apply to the character, and the character that way is different, and it's spontaneous at the same time.
Mm-hmm. How does it work the other way around? If your Lucia is suddenly different today than she was yesterday, does that throw you, or does that inspire you?
Oh, no, that's fun. That's when theater gets fun, when mm-hmm. you can take that person and play off of her. Mm-hmm. And I had an experience once where that man I was playing with was absolute genius, Renato Capecchi, mm-hmm. who's staging...
Our Daughter of the Regiment.
Right. He's an absolute genius, and we were working in England, and he did something with a port decanter. He never did it before. He just happened to pull the decanter top off at that moment, and I said, I'm not going to marry your daughter, which was my line. And he simply put the top of the container right back on. I mean, it stopped the show. And he never did it before. I just put the container off and poured lines never were said for a long time. But we just enjoyed the moment, and the audience did too.
How much do you enjoy the rehearsal process when the original characterization sort of gets molded? Judith Forrest told us that she enjoys the input of a conductor who is worried about every phrase. Do you like that, or do you prefer to be left more on your own?
No, I like that too, because I have certain things that I feel I can add to the performance. My input as a singer, vocalist, my input as an actor, the way I feel and the way I approach the role. In many ways, those things can interfere with the music, because let's say I feel something differently, and the maestro says, well, I want to do it this way. Well, he's got 100 people in the orchestra he's got mm-hmm. to do it with. We have to agree, and of course, I'm more or less happy to let him give me what he feels he wants to happen at that moment. That way we combine the theater.
An operatic performance is really a collaboration. You know, it's not, I'm doing it my way, Charlie, good luck to you. You know, it really, there has to be a meeting of the minds. And I think the more input you can get from your colleagues on stage and the director and the conductor, the better off you'll be, because then you find your way quicker to the point that you want to reach.
Beverly, we've talked many, many times on these programs of the ways in which you audition singers, in which you hear them and so forth. How do you go about auditioning or selecting a conductor? How can you really tell whether the result of something is the conductor's doing, or whether you just happen to have a good or bad cast that day?
Well, in terms of auditioning, obviously you can't play a record and have somebody stand up in front and wave his arm. So we have to travel a lot. I travel a lot and listen to actual performances, and I'll make an honest confession to you. I look at a conductor and think, would I like to have sung with that man or woman? And if the answer is no, I don't hire them. And perhaps that's not the most interesting way to hire one, but I feel that opera, without the singer, you just don't have an opera. And if I don't feel he's sympathetic, if I feel I've been watching a singer and the singer obviously wants to push it along a little bit, singers are not capricious people on stage. It's a very lonely time when you're up there. Nobody can come to your rescue if you're in trouble. And if you're having a good night, you don't want anybody to come to your rescue. But if for some reason a singer feels the need, for instance, to push the tempo a little bit, I think it behooves the conductor to look up and try to figure out in a split second what is creating this need. and not fight it. Now, I'm not saying to give in to every whim of the singer any more than the singer should give in to every whim of a conductor. If it's too fast, it's too fast. You can't sing it that fast. It's dumb to do it at that tempo. Mm-hmm. It's dumb to say the singer before you was able to do it. Totally different instruments that you're looking at. So I look primarily from a singer's or an ex-singer's point of view as to whether he's a sympathetic conductor to the vocalist. I have to admit, that's my primary thought. I like neatness and tidiness in the playing. There's no question about that. I like a good arm because there's a lot of distance between the singer and the conductor. And if it's a kind of vague, arm-waving, egotistical performance on the podium, forget it. It's not going to get 2 feet near the company. But if it's somebody that has a very secure arm, a good technique, and you can tell that in a split second, and looks up, let's say, twice in 5 minutes at the stage, he has a pretty good chance of coming in. But, you know, if the head is buried in the score or only concerned with the sound that the orchestra is making, then he should be with the symphony. But when you've got 60 or 70 people up on the stage relying on you for assistance, encouragement, tempo, participation, I feel the relationship between the singers and the conductor is primary asset for the company. So when I look at a conductor, that's what I look for.
Amen.
Amen from Harry Dvorak. Harry, what else are you doing with City Opera?
Harry's known as Busy Bass.
I see. Well, I'm doing Turandot and Puritanis in the fall.
Lucia's.
Well, that's my season this year.
Mm-hmm. Very good. So we'll be seeing you frequently at City Opera.
Yes, you will.
Aren't you on the Magic Flute this season?
No.
How did you miss that one?
I don't know.
I have just, to talk to you about it.
Just lucky, I guess.
Yeah, I thought you were going to say that. So I had a feeling we had a discussion about the Magic Flute. However, we'll discuss it.
Oh. That's the trouble with having your boss here in the audience. You know, it's hard to get away with things. Anyway, Harry Dvorak, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you very much.
Look forward. Be well. Thank you. All right, we will continue with our City Opera salute, but first we're going to pause. Elizabeth Knighton is the singer, once again with pianist Robert de Kunick. What a melting aria that is. Every time I hear it, sort of ooze out all over again. From La Rondine, Elizabeth Knighton, welcome.
Thank you.
Greetings.
Nice to be here.
What was your experience in this last season when you introduced it?
Oh, it was a wonderful experience. It was my debut, and I couldn't have asked for more. I had the very nicest people with whom I worked, and greatest support from the company, and I had a lot of fun.
Well, you can not ask for much more than that.
No, I don't think so.
What was your system in arriving at the company? How did it work?
Well, I believe I was singing a production of Faust in Poughkeepsie, New York.
Really?
And I was told that Miss Sills and Mr. Hazard were going to come and visit. And so
Poughkeepsie?
Mr. Hazard is our music administrator.
You go to
Poughkeepsie? Just so you don't think I'm running around the country. Sure, my husband's listening and I have to cover my tracks.
And, I was very surprised because I am quite certain that I arrived at Poughkeepsie by covered wagon. Mm-hmm. And I know it's a long drive.
I tell you, Elizabeth, actually, I heard you before then, which is why I went to Poughkeepsie.
Oh, you did?
I heard you when you were auditioning for Glyndebourne and you sang an aria from Semele.
That's right.
And I was standing in the back of the hall because I was doing a little business with the Christies from... and as I walked in, you walked right up to do the Semele aria.
Uh-huh.
And I asked what your name was, and I wrote it down in my little blue book. And I thought, at some point, I'd like to see this woman in performance because I'd like to see what she does. She's, as you can see, a very beautiful girl and has a wonderful figure. And I thought that could be a great addition to the company. I'd like to see what she does with a role. And when I learned that she was doing the Faust in Poughkeepsie, I decided we could probably handle Poughkeepsie. And so we went up to hear the Marguerite, and I was really very much impressed with the characterization and how beautifully she sang it. And so I came back and invited her to do the Rondine.
Wonderful. Well, once again, we are most grateful to you for joining us today and wish you continued success. Any other roles coming up at City Opera?
Not at City Opera, but I'll be doing my first Mimi's.
Not this season. Just this season.
I'll be doing my first Mimi's this year.
Great.
And I'm very excited about
Wonderful.
That.
Wonderful. Wonderful.
Thank you.
Again, thanks so much for joining us, Elizabeth Knighton.
Exciting, very, you know, kind of nervous.
Have you begun rehearsing there yet?
Yes, but Miss Rolandi is doing the majority of the rehearsals right now, and I'm mm-hmm. watching her and getting to know the production.
Miss Dobish is one of 33 American artists who are making their debut in the 1985 season. Mm. I'm kind of happy about that because I have been saying that we are not only a feeder company for all the other great opera companies of the world, and that, of course, is from Mr. Macaulay's point of view. I mean, Barry has sung in San Francisco and the Chicago Lyric, and so we are feeding a lot of other mm-hmm. companies. But in addition to that, my dream has always been that the New York City Opera get the recognition it deserves because it promotes, prepares, protects, preserves the young American artist and presents them in what we hope is the most advantageous manner. And so when Miss Dobish came to audition, she sang the Lucia arias, and I found her voice really quite beautiful, and I liked the way she had prepared it. I consider myself a Lucia expert.
That's right. You can't get away with too much.
I want to say it's a little bit nerve-wracking having to sing it for you.
Oh, well, it shouldn't be, because I know people say they get a little nervous, but you really shouldn't.
Barry, what did you sing for your audition, you remember? Or didn't you audition?
I was singing Faust in San Francisco for my audition.
Yes. You
were doing Thais.
Actually, I heard Barry, you see, long before I became the general director of the company, we were both singing.
But you still had a little blue book with you.
Well, I thought, look at this tall tenor, why don't I have it? That was what I was, from a very selfish point of view, having gotten a bad back from scrunching down to sing with so many small ones, I thought, why doesn't anybody give me something that sings like that? So when I came in, I started to chase him.
That was my audition.
That was his audition, yes.
Very good. Well, I wish we could talk longer, but our time is starting to fly away. And Gail Dobish, Barry McCauley, you've said you would give us a duet from Lucia. Will you?
Mm-hmm.
Once again, our pianist, assistant conductor at New York City Opera, is Robert de Kunick. We have run way past our allotted time, but you didn't want to hear the news anyway when you could... Oh, marvelous, marvelous. Duet from Lucia, Gail Dobish, Barry McCauley. We were talking about dramatic performances. This had to be seen as well as heard.
Too much smooching. I was talking about that.
Well, it's been a wonderful morning. Again, the City Opera season opens this Friday. The number 870-5570. Our artists this morning have been Beverly Sills, Judith Forrest, Harry Dworchak, Elizabeth Knighton, and of course just now Gail Dobish and Barry McCauley, with assistant conductor Robert Dick Hunick, our pianist. Thank you all for joining us.
Il giardino verrai cor ti trovo al cor. Dio me saude. Oh.
Thank you. Perché sul viso è perso